In a resolution plan, there can be no difference between an FC and an OC, that is, a financial creditor and an operational creditor, in the matter of payment of dues, and therefore, financial creditors and operational creditors deserve equal treatment under a resolution plan. This was the order passed by the NCLAT in the matter of SR Steel, and accordingly, the NCLAT has redistributed the proceeds payable under the approved resolution plan as per the method of calculation adopted by it, so that all financial creditors and operational creditors will be paid 60.7% of their admitted claims. However, this order has raised severe concerns in the credit market on account of the uncertainty it can cause. Subsequently, the matter landed in the Supreme Court, wherein the Apex Court made significant observations which provided certain relief. Hello and welcome to We Listen, India's first podcast channel on insolvency law. This is Prakul, and alongside me, I have with me Mr. Himanshu Gupta, a law graduate from Hidayatullah National Law University, and is currently pursuing graduate insolvency program to become an insolvency professional. And we are here to discuss this case at length. Hi Himanshu, welcome to We Listen.
Hello Prakul, it's good to be back. So, let's begin with the questions.
Yeah, Himanshu. So, Himanshu, the NCLAT observed that there cannot be any difference between a financial creditor and an operational creditor, and that they deserve equal treatment under a resolution plan. How did the Supreme Court contradict this view?
So, Prakul, the NCLAT held that there should not be any, because NCLAT interpreted, according to the Supreme Court, the NCLAT interpreted the equity principle to be the equality principle. Now, which was a wrong interpretation in light of this decision of the Supreme Court. So, NCLAT held that, so if they have securities or they do not have securities, NCLAT totally obliterated the concept of secured transactions and the concept of security. So, Supreme Court held that there are, and quoting the Swiss Ribbons judgment in which Supreme Court had upheld the constitutional validity of the code, Supreme Court again reiterated the same, that there are fundamental differences between the financial creditor and operational creditors. And while going back to the BLRC, that is going back to the basics, the Supreme Court held that, okay, so there are differences, the financial creditors are involved with a corporate debtor from the beginning of its life. Operational creditors come in later, at a later part. It's the financial creditor who provide finance for the starting of a company, and operational creditors are the ultimate beneficiaries of that credit, because they are the ones who provide goods and services raised by finances given by these financial creditors. Moreover, they have experts who are experts in their respective fields, and who assess the viability of these debts and viability and feasibility of a corporate debtor's business, and are involved from the beginning. Operational creditors have a easy way out as compared to financial creditors, because financial creditors have a long-term payment plans, and they cannot just simply back off. Operational creditors, it's way too easy for them to exit. They can simply just exit. They can stop the supply and it's over for them. For financial creditors, they'll have to first declare it NPA. They'll have to recall. They'll have to ask for lump sum payment. And even then, if they don't get it, then they'll have to drag the corporate debtor through insolvency proceedings, which might go on for quite some time. So in that case, there are stark differences which were held by the Supreme Court in Swiss Ribbons case, which were reiterated in this case as well. So that is how Supreme Court differentiated between financial creditors and operational creditors, and told that they are not on equal footing. However, they have to be decided on the basis of equity, that is, treating equals equally and treating unequals unequally. So that is the principle that Supreme Court interpreted in this case.
Okay, Himanshu. So going further, taking your argument further as to the security interest, as you rightly pointed out, NCLAT held that security and security interests are irrelevant at the stage of resolution, and particularly for the purpose of allocation of payments. And they also opined that Section 53 cannot be applied during the CIRP. So what did the Supreme Court observe, and what was Supreme Court's ruling in this regard?
So Prakul, the thing with the security interest is that Supreme Court, if we go back to the judgment, and while reading the judgment, even I noticed the Supreme Court discussed the concept of a secure transaction in length while quoting a lot of reports from IMF, from the World Bank, and even from the BLRC itself, by laying down and establishing what is the importance of a security contract and how secure there is a sanctity to the secure transactions, because secure transactions basically sustain the business of a corporate debtor. They make it easy for the corporate debtor or any entity doing business to avail credit, and that too credit at a cheaper rate. And it also gives some certainty to the lender that if my credit is not realized, I can recover the same by enforcing my security interest. And this also sort of creates a credit market, because otherwise that credit which becomes available on account of security would not have otherwise been available to that company. So in that case, secured transactions form the backbone of credit markets in a sense. And if that difference is obliterated by a judgment of the court, then that would be totally against the objectives of the court. Even the Supreme Court said that the code envisages maximization of value of assets of the corporate debtor and keep balancing the interest of all stakeholders. So where is the balancing of interest of secured creditors if security interest is not given due parlance in this course of conduct? And that would have been adversely impacting the entire insolvency regime, because then even the Supreme Court observed this, that secured creditors would be more incentivized to vote for liquidation rather than resolution of the corporate debtor.
This is the case.
Yes, because in that case, because they would not get anything, they would be equivalent to unsecured operational creditors, which are way below in section 53 liquidation waterfall. And secured creditors can simply, under section 52 of the code, enforce their security interest and take it out. That would have reduced the value of the corporate debtor's assets and the business of corporate debtor as whole, because at times it may happen that some assets are underlying as a security with one creditor, other with other creditors. So if they have to come together and negotiate with each other, there has to be a going concern basis, and that is possible only if these different security interests are not basically enforced by these creditors.
Okay.
So in that case, security interest has to be given a certain emphasis. Further, if we see section 53, so Supreme Court specifically held that section 53 is to be looked only for the purpose of providing minimum amount in the resolution, and it's not for the purpose of giving priority of how the claims are to be satisfied. So basically, when a resolution plan comes up, while approving the resolution plan, if we go to section 30, then it says that the committee of creditors may take into account, among other things, the distribution of claims under section 53. So Supreme Court interpreted that by saying that it is not the priority of claims that has to be looked upon from section 53, but the minimum amount. The same was argued by the government counsel as well while defending this amendment. So the Supreme Court agreed to that argument, that it is only the minimum amount, because earlier operational creditors were given a liquidation value which used to be usually nil, and dissenting financial creditors suffered a cram down where they had to take whatever was given in the resolution applicant, and usually resolution applicant forced the dissenting financial creditor to take a nil value, either to agree to their resolution plan or take a nil value. So but now, after this amendment, the dissenting financial creditors and operational creditors have been given a fallback option, that even if they do not get what they actually wanted, they would have a certain minimum amount that has to be given, and this amount has to be justiciable in front of the court of law, that interest of all stakeholders have been dealt with in the resolution plan, and that is to be looked in from the point of view of creditors' security and other factors as to how much it is pending, and how a resolution applicant and the COC dealt with their interests.
So yeah, this adequately answers even the constitutional validity of section amendment made to section 30. So let's go to the next question, Himanshu. So when it comes to distribution of funds in a resolution plan, who gets to decide that? Is it the resolution professional, the committee of creditors, the NCLT, NCLAT, or the prospective resolution applicant?
So Prakul, like going back to the Swiss Ribbons case, the Supreme Court in this case upheld that resolution professional's role is limited to that of an administrator. At best, what he can do while looking at a resolution plan under section 30, he has to check the validity of a resolution plan under section 30 subsection 2, where there are certain factors given which have to be touched upon by the resolution professional, and give his professional opinion that whether operational creditors have been given their dues or not, whether the plan is in contravention or is compliant with the laws for the time being in force, among other things. So in that case, he just have to provide an opinion, and he is not an adjudicator as to he cannot just go to the COC and adjudicate that take this plan, do not take this plan, or this plan is not viable for the corporate debtor. No, nothing at all has to be done of this sort by the resolution professional. The only thing he is required to do is check and give his professional opinion, and he can take opinion help of other experts as well in this case. For example, if the plan is compliant with the laws of for the time being in force, he can take the help of legal professionals, qualified lawyers, and provide his opinion. Now COC can accept or may not accept this opinion and go on according to what they see as viable and feasible in a resolution plan. Now this one specific factors may be justiciable in front of court of law, that the because the court of law is the one to decide whether something is in compliant with law or not. But as to the viability and feasibility of the resolution plan, the court held that it is the exclusive domain of the committee of creditors. So it is the committee of creditors who takes the decision whether to first of all keep the corporate debtor as a going concern or not, or whether to liquidate it. If we see section 33, it also gives an option to the committee of creditors to liquidate the corporate debtor even before a resolution plan is approved. So in that case, it is the committee of creditors who has the prime power to do things in a certain way and to decide the fate of a corporate debtor. And along with that, the Supreme Court went back to the Mihir H. Mafatlal versus Mafatlal Industries case, where it held that although the court does not act as a mere rubber stamp to approve the resolution or approve the whatever the majority has upheld, but it is also the court which has to see that it does not overstep its boundaries in matters that are commercial, because that is neither the expertise nor the domain of the court, and it is only the experts and the commercial players who have a say in this matter. So in this case, the Supreme Court held that committee of creditors has the ultimate commercial wisdom to deal with interest of all stakeholders. As for the NCLT and NCLAT, their jurisdiction is limited to checking the plan's validity on the four corners of what has been provided under section 30 subsection 2, read with section 31 clause 1. So in this case, this adjudicating authority or the appellate authority has to basically check whether the resolution plan is in adherence to those factors or not, and that is a very limited jurisdiction which is given upon the NCLT and NCLAT, they being creatures of a statute and they do not have any further powers than what has been granted by the statute, in this case being the Insolvency and Bankruptcy Code 2016. So in this case, if the resolution plan passes those thresholds which have been given under section 30 and subsection 60 along with 661 for NCLT and NCLAT. So if those thresholds are passed, then there is nothing that can be justiciable in before the Honorable Appellate Authority or the Adjudicating Authority at all. As for the prospective resolution applicant, it is up to him that what kind of treatment he wants to give to different creditors. And we can see if we look at section 30 that our distribution in a resolution plan shall be fair and equitable. So it is the resolution applicant who has to check that he has dealt with the interest of all stakeholders, he provides for how the plan is viable and feasible, and how he tends to implement that plan. These things have to be provided by prospective resolution applicant. As to the specific amount given to an individual creditor, this is one thing which our prospective resolution applicant can propose, but it is up to the COC again to negotiate on behalf of any creditor, because it is the COC which represents the interest of all stakeholders, and it has to, while looking at payment of different creditors, it also has to look at how the corporate debtor would be kept as, how the value of corporate debtor would be maximized, and how the objective of resolution has to be achieved. So of course there are going to be haircuts, and haircuts ideally resolution applicant would provide on its own, because COC would not voluntarily take haircut, but these are things subject to negotiations. And in this, if we also see, there were some subcommittees made by the corporate debtors COC. So Supreme Court also gave emphasis that subcommittees may be made for the purpose of administration and negotiation, but the ultimate authority under section 28 of the code lies with the COC. If COC ratifies such actions, or the everything is being done with the COC's permission under section 28, these actions are valid and cannot be questioned.
So now, Himanshu, the Supreme Court in addition to all this, has also made an important observation on the timelines under the code while upholding the constitutional validity of the amendment made to Section 12. Can you elaborate on the same?
So, Prakul, the earlier Section 12, as it stood before the amendment, was it gave a time limit of 180 days for completion of CRP with an extension of one-time extension of 90 days, thereby taking the total time limit to 270 days. But now, after the amendment, it has been increased to 330 days, including the time taken in litigation and in courts. So, the Supreme Court observed, by looking at the intention of the legislature, by looking through what the background was or what the circumstances were in existence at the time of bringing in the code by the legislature. So Supreme Court, while going through those factors and while going through earlier legislations also, observed that time limit was one crucial factor which had marred the insolvency regime in the country, because every time whether it's RDD, BFI Act, whether it's SICA, whether it's SARFAESI, everywhere the courts were not properly equipped, or there were a lot of backlogs in the entire regime. So in that case, timelines had to be fixed, and court agreed that okay, there is some scope of experimentation when it comes to economic legislation, that legislature has to be given some freedom. But again, that freedom should not impinge on anybody's fundamental rights. So in this case also, it was argued that since there was a limitation, mandatory limitation put on of 330 days time limit for completion of the entire corporate insolvency resolution process, it was in a way correct on part of the legislature, but this word mandatory did not go well with the judiciary, because when the legislature tries to dictate as to how the court should function, it is not within the realm of the constitution, as these powers have been differentiated within the constitution itself. So the Supreme Court held that all right, ideally this process should be completed within the time period of 330 days. But this time limit of 330 days is not mandatory. However, it is an outer limit within which a resolution professional and all the stakeholders have to complete the process. But if there are some extenuating circumstances which are beyond the control of any parties, then such time limit may be extended on a case-to-case basis. For example, if we see there is a long backlog in NCLT, NCLATs, so there is a saying in Latin, actus curae neminem gravabit, which means that an act of court shall prejudice or harm no one. Supreme Court, while referring to this Latin maxim, held that sometimes it is not the fault of any party at all. It's just the court's process that takes time. It is the legal process which goes with its own speed. So in these cases, the litigant should not be affected and their rights should not be impinged. So in these cases, such time limits may be extended, and hence by giving this rationale, Supreme Court struck down the word mandatory from this subsection and upheld the 330 day time limit by saying that had we struck down the entire section, ideally we would have struck down, but striking down the entire section would have been akin to throwing the baby out with the bathwater, and that is not something very much appreciated when it comes to economic legislations. Hence, Supreme Court only removed the word mandatory and upheld the outer time limit of 330 days as ordinary.
So, Himanshu, what are the other aspects which the Supreme Court had ruled on while finally pronouncing its judgment in this matter?
So, Prakul, there are some other aspects also which Supreme Court discussed. So, first of all, the extinguishment of guarantee issue, because Supreme Court had also dealt with this issue in the case of State Bank of India versus V. Ramakrishnan, in which it had upheld that the resolution plan would bind on the guarantors as well. So in this case, the financial creditors argued that extinguishment of guarantees should not be allowed, because even the resolution plan may also provide for recovery of some dues from the guarantors, personal guarantors, which are promoters or directors of the corporate debtor. In this case, the Supreme Court held that although the corporate debtor may not be weighted down by the guarantees cropping up, and it used the very specific phrase, the Hydra heads popping up while dealing with guarantees. So Supreme Court upheld that such guarantees, such right of subrogation may not lie, must not lie with the promoters, but financial creditors are free to enforce their guarantees that were given by the promoters and directors of the corporate debtor. So in this case, even the end plan itself, while providing for these extinguishment of guarantees, is valid in its totality, and these financial creditors are free to recover their money while going through different routes for recovery of such guarantees, such as SARFAESI and other laws. The other issue, which was although factual in nature, dealt with by Supreme Court, was of CIRP surplus. So Supreme Court, without going into any question of law, observed that as the request for proposal issued already provided for the non-distribution of this proceeds of CIRP surplus, that is the profit which the corporate debtor generated during the CIRP period, that it was specifically written that it should not be distributed between the creditors, upheld that it would go to the resolution applicant as in accordance with the terms of the documents provided.
Okay. Thank you so much, Himanshu, for summarizing the entire judgment of the SR Steel in with ease of explanation, and also by giving us the rationale behind each observation made by the Supreme Court. So this is it on the SR Steel judgment. So we will have more podcasts with Himanshu on various landmark judgments passed by the Supreme Court. Thank you so much. Thank you, Himanshu.
Thank you, Prakul. Thank you for inviting me.
Thank you. Stay tuned to We Listen by subscribing to our podcast.